The fact that Woolf was exclusively concerned with the thoughts and feelings of a tiny social elite is evident in all her books, including her best-known and arguably most successful novel, To the Lighthouse. Although To the Lighthouse is by no means a realistic novel, it does have a specific geographical location, a Hebridean island, and Woolf's treatment of this location is highly revealing. The Hebrides have a rich history and culture, but that is completely obliterated because Woolf simply wants to design a decorative background against which she can display her uniquely sensitive metropolitan characters. The fact that almost all of Woolf's characters are well-bred southerners might perhaps be excused on the basis that a writer has to write about the people she knows best. But it's clear from her other novels that Woolf was actually an incorrigible snob who wrote about the upper and upper middle classes because she regarded them as naturally superior. The most blatant example of Woolf's cringing respect for the upper classes is that bizarre historical fantasy Orlando, which tells the story of a 500-year-old aristocrat who's seen as the repository of all civilized values.
It seemed to put an orgy of snobbery. The Australians have a verb to brown nose. This seemed to me to be the sort of apotheosis of brown nosing as an extended valentine a slobbering valentine to a member of the upper classes. It filled me with astonishment, actually, as much as anything else.
Distasteful as Woolf's snobbery undoubtedly is, it's by no means the worst aspect of her persona. What's truly shocking about her writing is the extent to which she upholds some of the most reprehensible features of Victorian ideology. Just listen to the jingoistic sentiments that are expressed in this extract from her first novel, The Voyage Out.
"You know, Dick, I can't help thinking of England," said his wife meditatively, leaning her head against his chest. "Being on this ship seems to make it so much more vivid, what it really means to be English. One thinks of all we've done, and our navies, and the people in India and Africa, and how we've gone on century after century sending out boys from little country villages, and of men like you, Dick. And it makes one feel as if one couldn't bear not to be English."
In a later novel, Mrs. Dalloway, Woolf's obsession with England's imperialist splendor is once again in full flood.
"She had the thought of empire always at hand, and had acquired from her association with that armored goddess her ramrod bearing, her robustness of demeanor, so that one could not figure her even in death parted from the earth or roaming territories over which, in some spiritual shape, the Union Jack had ceased to fly. To be not English, even among the dead? No, impossible."
Mention these passages to Woolf's supporters, and you get the standard response. "That's not her talking," they'll say. "It's simply the character. Don't you see? It's ironic." But if that passage about the thought of empire is tongue-in-cheek, how do you explain the odious prejudices found in her diaries and letters, where it is the author's voice that we hear? In the privacy of her diary, Woolf revealed attitudes and beliefs which flatly contradict her enlightened image. Time and time again, the reader comes across breathtakingly bigoted observations.
"Saturday, 9th of January, 1915. On the towpath, we met and had to pass a long line of imbeciles. The first was a very tall young man, just queer enough to look twice at, but no more. The second shuffled and looked aside, and then one realized that everyone in that long line was a miserable, ineffective, shuffling, idiotic creature, with no forehead or no chin, and an imbecile grin or a wild, suspicious stare. Perfectly horrible.
and they should certainly be killed.
Wednesday, May the 17th, 1925. And so home, passing a nigger gentleman, perfectly fitted out in swallowtail and bowler and gold-headed cane. And what were his thoughts? Of the degradation stamped on him every time he raised his hand and saw it black as a monkey's outside, tinged with flesh colour within?
Perhaps the most shameful aspect of Woolf's Victorian outlook was her rabid anti-Semitism. In 1912, shortly after marrying Leonard Woolf, who was Jewish, she wrote to a friend,
"How I hated marrying a Jew. How I hated their nasal voices and their oriental jewellery and their noses and their wattles. They can't die. They exist on a handful of rice and a thimble of water. Their flesh dries on their bones, but they still pullulate, copulate, and amass millions of money."
This repellent series of remarks is no aberration. Woolf's diaries and correspondence are stuffed with similar comments. And yet even this side of her is excused by the defenders of her reputation. Everyone was anti-Semitic in those days, they say. You have to allow for the prejudices of the age she lived in. Nonsense. Many of her contemporaries, James Joyce, for instance, who made a Jew the hero of his great epic Ulysses, were free of the bigotry she exhibited. And what's truly appalling is that Woolf, who was married to a Jew, and who was well aware of what was going on in Nazi Germany, never shed her anti-Semitic opinions.
Oh, yes, please, Mrs. Woolf. Thank you.
In February 1940, as rumours about the Nazi death camps were breaking down anti-Jewish prejudice in even the most reactionary recesses of British society, Virginia Woolf spent an afternoon in the company of Dr. Rita Hindon, an expert on colonial affairs. Later, in her diary, Woolf described Dr. Hindon as a swarthy, hook-nosed, red-cheeked, racy Jewess. And she added,
"Now at tea she shriveled into the common, the lemon on steel, acid vulgarity of the obvious, the cheap, hard Jewess which at lunch I hadn't seen."
Nothing could obliterate the aftertaste of Woolf's vicious opinions. But I, for one, wouldn't think quite so badly of her if her writing were one-tenth as good as her supporters claim. But it isn't.
If you look at the novels of Virginia Woolf and you look at the novels of George Eliot, it is certainly true that Virginia Woolf broke all sorts of moulds. It is also true, in my view, that George Eliot was infinitely the better novelist. She covered more ground. She was just as artistically complex. She went much, much deeper into the nature of the lives of the sexes, the political life of the country, and all sorts of other things. Virginia Woolf's revolt was both agonized and frivolous, and one admires it, but rather coldly, I think. All her characters somehow add up to one large Virginia Woolf, and she is surveying it like a kind of god from a distance.
Would you say she was a great stylist then?
It's easy to be a good stylist if there's not much content that you have to bother with. A more direct answer to your question would be that on occasions, yes, she seems to me to write extremely well. On many occasions, she writes incredibly badly. And the prose poems that interleave the chapters or the sections of the waves, for example, seem to me so bad as to be almost incredible.
The birds sang emulously in the clear morning air, swerving high over the elm tree, singing together as they chased each other, escaping, pursuing, pecking each other as they turned high in the air. And then, tired of pursuit and flight, lovelily they came descending.
Lovelily?
Lovelily. They came descending. Delicately, declining, dropped down and sat silent on the tree, on the wall, with their bright eyes glancing, and their heads turned this way, that way, aware, awake, intensely conscious of one thing, one object in particular.
This is fine writing at its most nebulous and its most forced. There's no real feel for language here or anywhere else in Woolf's work. It's simply decorative. And so is this.